So pretty much I talked to you about some of the issues here. And one of the two main things that I want to touch on is how life went about with the border before crossing it from the Mexican side to the American side became illegal. So there, yes, there was a time in which those type of crossings were legal. So that would be kind of our breaking point, and I put 1964 roughly, because that's the time in which a big program called the Bracero program, talk about it, ended, which brought people, mainly men from Mexico, to work on the US railroad, farms and so forth. And then right after that, 64, then the situation changes and the word undocumented illegal comes into place, and from there on it's another situation. So those are kind of the big markers here. And obviously, as we get closer to the present, the complexities just explode. And I'm just highlighting a couple of them. Of course, immigration issues with trade and what that brings about or comes with, and indeed violence. So broadly, that. Oh, this is too dark, I'm sorry. So one of the things that I want to start off with, historically. So there was a time when Mexico became independent, 1821, and inherited this big swath of land up north. Not many people up there, not people from central Mexico wanted to go because it was hot, it was, no, the weather, no, the land was not as fertile, so there was an issue. So what did the Mexican government did? Well, came up with this great plan as to bringing colonists to that area and open the door to Anglo-American colonists to come over. And that's where Houston and friends come into place. And the deal was that these colonists will make this oath to become Mexican citizens, to adopt the Catholic religion, and in exchange, they will get tracts of land, free tax-free things, and that was the deal. So, worked pretty good for those colonists. This was 1824. In 6 years, the number of colonists surpassed those native Mexicans, and the Mexican government just stopped this particular program. So that is the situation up until the 1830s, in which there is another change in Mexico, where the central government decides to tighten the grip on the different states and a power centralized in Mexico City, so that those colonists back in Texas could not even name their own authorities. That's not going to work for Texans. Alongside with that, Mexico had abolished slavery. That also was another situation that prevented those colonists from pursuing their slave plantation economy. So those two things are going to provide enough of arguments for Texans to split from Mexico. This is 1835, roughly, and become the Republic of Texas that I think all of you know what we were talking about. However, this is the problem. Texas, the Republic of Texas, established its own border, claiming that it was all the way to the Rio Grande. Mexico said absolutely not. This is up to the Nueces River. So that is one of the main points of contention, and this is going to provide another opportunity for more problems. So up to this time, Republic of Texas, an entity that does not belong to the US yet, it's its own thing. Mexico does not recognize it, Mexican people consider Texans to be ungrateful. Didn't we open the door to them? Look at what they're doing. So here you can see the beginning of that animosity, anti-Texan or anti-American, soon enough. So, long story short, with these ideas about borders, Mexican troops crossed back and forth this alleged Texan Republican boundary, the Rio Grande, and in one of those occasions, some skirmishes came about. Some Texan peoples ended up killed in those encounters, and there you have the argument for war, 1846. So these are two moments, 1835 and then 1846. This is a war, absolutely enormously significant for our own state even, because what occurs at this point is that the United States, President Polk, comes forward and says, yes, we are with Texas. Yes, eventually Texas is going to become part of the United States. So in the eyes of Mexico, that was also an act of aggression. Polk is saying, blood was spilled in American land. We need to fight. Of course, many controversies as to how fair this war was. Was it just an opportunity to expand? So forth and so on. But we will leave it there. So, war it is then. Of course, the battles are going to be pretty one-sided at first, if you will, because the United States had the resources to go about land and naval power enough to. So the Mexican government was led by this man, last name Santa Ana, with an enormous ego. The guy thought that he could just walk from central Mexico, from Mexico City, all the way up north and stop those ungrateful Texans, and people along the way will join him, and then when he ends up somewhere up north, he will have enough of an army. Of course, that's not going to happen. Well, that didn't happen. So there is the situation in which, this is 1846, by 1847, the American troops are in Mexico City. They are, well, the invaders in the eyes of Mexicans. The troops are going to stay in Mexico for roughly a year. Those Mexicans will not concede defeat. People on the streets will fight neighborhood by neighborhood. And there's another element that I just want to touch on here. This was not a walk on the park, as Americans probably decided at that point. This was roughly 2 years, and because there was a lot at stake for Mexico. Religion played a crucial role here. On the one hand, priests at that time were warning Mexicans, you need to fight, roughly, you need to fight, because what would happen if the Americans who have this Protestant religion were to dominate Mexico? We would not only lose our homeland, we would lose also our soul. I don't know how many of you might be Catholic, but there's this idea within the Catholic religion that, well, there's eternal life and your soul, you know, will live forever, and you can do many things to save it, roughly. So this was a crucial moment. And fights went about in neighborhoods within Mexico City. People will throw even, you know, hot water to the troops, anything to defeat the Americans. And another thing that happened is that the troops, the American troops, also had an important immigrant contingent from Ireland. So those Irish people also had the Catholic faith. And soon enough, they saw that they had more in common with Mexicans than with Americans. And they switched sides. So, war. And the defeat, bittersweet, of course. but it's 1848. And that's the date that is the most important for us, because it is the date that the border is set along the, this is the other complexity, along the Rio Bravo for Mexicans and along the Rio Grande for Americans. Same river, different ways to call it. So this is a treaty that was pretty cheap, because 50 million were paid for roughly 8 states of Mexico. In other words, Mexico lost almost half of its territory for that same reason. This is a war that Mexicans do not forget, generation upon generation. You can ask basically even today any Mexican, and they will say something like it was stolen, it was taken, all kinds of things. So this is significant even for New Mexicans, because if you take a look at our state government page, we even have an office for issues dealing with the Treaty of Guadalupe and Hidalgo, the 1848 treaty. So this tells us that the issue of land ownership was not resolved in 1848, and it continues to raise a number of issues. And not only land, but water and other resources as well. So, 1848, how respected was this border? Well, it will take time, but what the immediate impact was, in the words of a very famous poet, writer, Gloria Anzaldúa, she would say something like, this border was a wound that separated not only the territory, but families. And we're talking not only Mexican families, but also Native American tribes that used to come and go, or who had family along this two sides of the new border. Fast forward, migration is going to start flowing from now Mexico to the United States, and the problems are going to be on how to regulate those flows of immigration. One of the key things here is going to be a disease. Right around the 1900s, epidemics will be a big issue. Yes, epidemics nowadays. So 1919, for instance, there's this telegram from El Paso mayor talking about the typhus epidemic, and allegedly Mexicans were bringing that with them. Something needed to be done. So we see here some of the beginnings of that border regulation. Bear in mind, there was no border patrol up to this point. Mexicans specifically can come and go. It was not as guarded as today, obviously. However, the beginnings of regulation, as I mentioned, came in the form of that card that identified those foreigners, those aliens, who crossed into the United States, and given the concern about the epidemics, they could certify that they were clean. And you can see here, so the process went about being bathed, vaccinated, and disinfected. So this is the beginning of that law enforcement staff on the US-Mexico border. Soon enough, it will be an immigration card, and so forth and so on. But I think that that's an interesting background to all this regulation. Another thing that we're looking at here is obviously how the stereotypes are being shaped. And again, what happens to a Mexican when it crossed the border at this particular time? So yes, it became a clean person, right, in the eyes of authorities, but you can just imagine for that particular person, what did that did to its psychology and so forth and so on. So, 1924, that's when we get the US Border Patrol created. So as of then, now, to cross that border will become a crime. And that sign right there is saying the opposite. To migrate is not a crime. And again, this is the complexity and misunderstanding, if you will. For many people, Mexicans and others, migrating is a necessity, it's a need. When people tell them that this is a crime, that's something that needs to be explained or not understood. So migration, how to regulate that, and the Border Patrol, obviously, will be a key enforcer of all this. One of the things that we will see again by 1930 with the Great Depression is going to be more of an emphasis on all these flows of Mexicans that had crossed the border up to that point. And given the fact that the economic crisis was pushing so many people to ask for, social benefits, the decision was, in many places such as California, Texas, the border states, to send those Mexicans back to their native lands. So many were just rounded up, put on a bus, and sent back to Mexico. In the mix, of course, many were already U.S. Citizens, but the point was not to check their documents, but just to send them back. We have to also highlight the fact that the Mexican government was supporting this to keep friendly relations. And from that point on, there was all this discussion about this episode, that should it be told, should it not be told. And the numbers are quite significant. If you can see that, that's from a Mexican publication. The highest number of people sent back to Mexico were around 148,000, and that was 1931, roughly the beginning of the Great Depression. And from there on, it just went up and down. So, sent back to Mexico. And the idea was, in the eyes of the American public or American newspapers like the LA Times, people were just going back to their native land. Many of these people have never been to Mexico. And here's where that famous phrase as to, we didn't cross the border crossed us, came up about, or fits perfectly, because Mexico was a foreign country for many of these people. And I just want to highlight, I think it's a fitting point here to think about within the controversy about what to teach ethnic groups or not. This repatriation episode was subject to a new law in California, 2015-2016, in which it was decided that this episode needed to be in students' history books to tell them about this particular repatriation. And again, another complexity, another controversy. Do we not? What does that do to ethnic Mexican kids? So, repatriation. So, fast forward. The Bracero program that I talked about. Right around World War II, there is the need to replace all those soldiers, all those men that were going to fight in the European battlefields. The United States needs arms. So brazos, that's the in Spanish. And Bracero, it's kind of a derivative of arms, Bracero. So, welcome to any Mexican working, hard-working men to the United States legally. So this is the legal program. The U.S. And Mexico agreed on this. This was a long program, 1942 to 1964, in which these Mexicans would come for 6 months or so, or for the season, and then they will go back. And this was amenable to many Americans because that's the way they liked it. Cheap labor, of course, clean, and this is the other process that we want to talk about as to crossing the border. What did it entail for those men to cross the border? And few are still alive, and they talk about, of course, this humiliating treatment of being disinfected and literally sprayed with nowadays banned products or pesticides, such as DDT and others. So this is, you know, so it's shocking to some extent. On the other hand, this Border Patrol or immigration enforcers were playing such a key role here in making sure that people that were admitted, men that were admitted, were not only disinfected, but also they could even show their hands. Is this a hardworking man? Is this not a union labor person that's going to create problems? So the key was to welcome hardworking people, people that were being, you know, taking orders, and no problematic people at all. So that's the Brazil program. And again, fast forward, throughout the 70s, right after 64, when the Bracero program ended, so anybody who wanted to cross the border would do so with the new tag, illegal, or the moniker at that time was, or still is, wetback, because again, what did it entail to cross the border? To get into the river that divides US and Mexico and get wet. And many ended up on the other side of the river with their back wet backs. So that was the way in which you would identify those people that were in this side of the border in the United States illegally. They were wet backs. So by 1986, the number of those undocumented people were such a large number that President Reagan at the time, a pretty charismatic and popular president, decided to sign this Immigration Reform Act of 1986, a crucial piece of legislation that opened the door for around 3 million or so of people, and not only from Mexico, but from anywhere in the world that were in the United States without legal status, and they could easily, resolve their illegal situation. A very important one, that once again, once this Reform Act passed, again, anybody that came will become an illegal person. And you can see here, the amount of people that crossed the border right after the 80s. There's so much discussion too as to when the 1986 immigration law was announced, flows of immigrants just came to the US to see if they could benefit from this law. Because one of the requisites was that you had to show that you were in the United States something like the beginning of the year of since 1982 or some other. So there were ways that people could come up with some proof. But again, the situation with illegal immigration continues, and more people are going to be coming, and not only from Mexico, but from Central America and other places. At the same time, the US Border Patrol will increase its vigilance throughout the border, and many creative, sometimes operation names will be put into place. And you can see again, right after 1980, the number of immigrants just went up and continued up, up until the beginning of the 2000s. I think we can, I don't have a graph, but we can compare how the number of crossers, illegal crossings on the border, also matched the budget that the US Border Patrol got, not only in terms of money and resources, but also people on the border. And fast forward, because we don't have much time, sorry. The other thing too, so trade, yeah, so we talked enough about people. What about merchandise? What about stuff? Well, 1994 is the time in which the United States, Canada, and Mexico sit down and drafted this trade agreement, NAFTA, and North American Free Trade Agreement, that consider that if Mexican immigrants and Central Americans and others were coming to the United States to work, well, why don't we prevent them from crossing the border and put factories on the southern side of the border? That way we will fix the immigration problem. That's what happened. The number of businesses that crossed south of the border to benefit from low wages, lax environmental laws, and others were enormous. Soon they started hiring women to do some, you know, delicate type of work and so forth and so on. And an unintended consequence of all this came about in the form of femicides. Many women started to just be killed right after finishing their work at the maquilas. So that's the name of the factories in Mexico, maquilas, maquiladoras, factories that just do stuff. They make stuff. So this new reality came to place on the US-Mexico border, and the missing young woman, a phenomenon that people could not still wrap their heads around this, but sadly an unintended product of this free trade agreement. But along with that, there's also plenty of benefits on the one hand, but also one of the downsides is that the agricultural sector in Mexico and Central America was completely ruined, because there was no way in the world that Mexico could play on an equal level with the United States and Canada. The United States subsidizes, gives money, helps their farmers. Mexico doesn't. Central America, not even mention it. So, plenty of unemployed people. Just hold that thought to connect it to the Central American caravans and other things. So, along with the treaty, and being friendly, and allowing merchandise to come and go, notice, merchandise can come and go, but not people. The other side to this, the militarization of the border. Because also, within the this time period, 9/11 just raised alarm bells all over the place, and there was this fear that, well, those terrorists or others could just sneak in through the US-Mexico border. So, once again, more resources in this narrative, this discourse of how dangerous and how violent and how terrible this border, US-Mexico border is, that the only way to, you know, get a grip on it is to throw money at it, invest more, and send the troops as much as possible. And of course, a lot of that is true. We can consider how in some sectors it's exaggerated because for political gain or other interests. Because the other reality, alongside with the ability of stuff to come and go across the border, well, not drugs, but drugs could easily make it up to the US-Mexico border, and from there on, once they cross into the United States, it's just like another merchandise. Which is sad if you stop and think about how much blood is spilled for those drugs to get from somewhere central Mexico to the border. So the reality hits in cultural terms. And again, the complexity and the interweaving of US and Mexican communities is blurred because some of the drug traffickers are going to be US-born people. One key example, if you came across this one, maybe not, is that guy on this right hand side, kind of a light-skinned guy born in Laredo, nicknamed La Barbie, because, looks, well, they call him Barbie, good looking and so on and so on. And that's the new attire of that drug trafficking, young drug trafficker, wear designer clothes and that type of persona that they created. And on the other hand, of course, El Chapo. An example, sadly, for many Mexicans as to what can be done with an elementary school education. And the Forbes magazine not helping much in featuring El Chapo as one of the wealthiest men in the world. And then when people go back and ask some elementary school kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? Sadly, you get not the response that you might be expecting. They don't want to be the Steve Jobs of the future. They want to be El Chapo. And there we have a tremendous problem. Not only, you know, in terms of education, but also how this connects to the border and to the ability of being able to sneak this illicit drugs across the border and become rich. So the militarization of the border is obviously needed, but you also need to think about how the music world plays at the tune of these drug traffickers and how this new culture, so-called narcocultura, narcoculture, crosses the US-Mexico border, because you find those songs playing on the great deeds of El Chapo and other minor drug lords. And people are dancing to it. So it becomes acceptable. It becomes a border thing. And as some of you might know, this comes along with also some so-called saints, La Santa Muerte, Saint Death, or Death as a saint, and other things that make this particular narco culture so, sadly, so alive, even in our own state. So, violence, of course, it's a reality, and this takes us also to the contradictory nature of the border, meaning that in Juarez, we saw the issue with women, and also the murder rate there is tremendous, compared to the most peaceful cities in the United States that happen to be on the border area, see El Paso, Laredo, and those other places in California. So the issue being that if you cross into Ciudad Juarez, 5 hours away from here, many of you have been there, that's the most dangerous city in the Americas, maybe. And if you cross into El Paso, that's one of the safest cities. And people wonder why that is. And of course, there are many stories. One of them being that actually the money from the drug traffic, it's kept in El Paso and other places. So you need to be pretty safe in that particular place. So the border, and the idea of a beautiful wall is actually quite important to think about, because out of the almost 2,000 mile or so of the border stretch, a lot of those places, they're not fortified with a wall. As you can see with the yellow, pretty much the border with California, bit of Arizona, is pretty much all the way up to El Paso, guarded by walls and other things. But there are these spaces which become the most dangerous places to cross into the United States. There need to be walled, if you will. And maybe that's the rationale for that particular policy that wanted to invest so much money to create another wall. But again, one might think, what good will that do if a guy like El Chapo and other, because you have to give to the drug traffickers, they're very creative. So they're no longer going by air or land, they're now, you know, digging tunnels and other things. So on the other hand, the sheer amounts of money given to the Customs and Border Patrol, and also to that new section, the ICE, it's called ICE, to detain people, to supervise them and so forth, it's quite enormous, and it has been increasing as the 2000 move along, as you can see here. So the border is very dangerous. We need to spend so much money, billions upon billions, to keep it safe. So, yes, keep it safe, because also there are other numbers that tell us that the number of Hispanic people, Latinx, or however you want to call it, is actually growing. And not only US citizens from Hispanic background, but also from undocumented. And the latest, roughly, it's almost 20 million people from Hispanic background, and around 11 or 12 million undocumented. So we do have a problem. And yes, we do benefit from this undocumented labor. We do have that challenge, and people are waiting to see what's going to happen to them with that. But to expect an immigration law like the one from Reagan, it's something to be seen, I think. So the latest images from this border is no longer just the Mexicans, or the idea that any Mexican cross the border no longer holds, because now we see the Central American people, not only Central America, but throughout Latin America, and even the Caribbean, the Haitians lately. And this is a long story that I'm just going to touch briefly here. So the idea of crossing from the Central American regions dates back, just going to go to the 80s. In the 80s, there were civil wars throughout Central America. There was this policy from Cuba to spread communism. It took a hold in some places, like Nicaragua. The United States felt the need to fight communism. And again, our President Reagan took a very proactive role on this. And what ended up happening is that many of those orphans from these wars came to the United States, the 80s or so, places like Los Angeles. Soon enough, they joined gangs. They got up into Central American gangs to fight against the Mexican gangs, and so forth. They got in trouble, those young peoples. And then the United States, using again the immigration laws, got all those gang people and sent them back to Central America. 90s or so. What did they do over there? Well, they took hold of their neighborhoods. They were running sort of a site government to the official government, charging taxes and doing all the things that supposedly only governments do, offering protection, and so forth. So that is one of the main issues that are pushing many Central Americans to come to the United States. So it's not only the impact of not having enough of resources to live off of the agricultural sector as they used to, but it is also the threat of these deadly gangs and corruption and many other things. So that many families are taking the tremendous decision of sending their young peoples to the United States unaccompanied, because either they're threatened by those gangs or they will soon join those gangs. So that's just one of the many complexities that I wanted to touch on. And sadly, again, well, the recent images on the border that continues to be that complex place that where being illegal is criminalized, where human rights are sometimes absent, and where we, with that image of the Border Patrol in horseback, this cowboy, we go back to that Wild West era. And that's kind of a shocking image of how this Haitian group was rounded up and sent back to Haiti. Things that we didn't touch, but just to add another complexity, environmental problems, water, and the sheer amount of pollutants sent to Mexico, and the border communities have to contend with this too. So regulations are pretty scarce on this particular issue. So to conclude, there's just so many, many issues, and we kind of just run the gamut from immigration to environment and just list them because we don't have time to go into this. And we talk briefly about, you know, what does the border or crossing the border do to people's identities from going back to being legal and maybe not, and passing all those hurdles to become acceptable once they land on the American side of the border. And just a broad idea about, you know, the border. Yes, it separates, but it also connects. So it is a bridge. And therein again lies the complexity and the irony, and for all of us to navigate through that to that issue of you know, crossing the border, and the meanings of having walls to protect, to defend, and then in the process to become imprisoned, or maybe hopefully to force us on this American side of the border to look around and look at our communities and what do we need to protect even more? What do we need to fix to be that ideal community that we want to protect with walls and all kinds of things? So let me just conclude with Diana put music there, so of course put some music. There's this one that I want to play. This is, I'm just going to play like a few seconds. This group, it's called Los Tigres del Norte. Many of you have heard about them. So the Tigers of the North. Amazing stories, each song is a story to itself, and this one is called We Are More American Than the North Americans. So I'm just going to play a bit of this, and it talks about this issue of crossing the border, and it touches on a bigger thing as to how the United States appropriated the word America. And that's kind of a rebuttal to that. We Mexicans and we Latin Americans are even more American than them. So I'm just going to play a little bit, and we'll open it up for comments and questions. Any questions, anything? Looking forward to that.